What's happened? What is this place? Maybe I'm dead. I can't see any light. Maybe I am dead. I can't get up. What's going on? What's happening to me? There's no one here, but these noises. God, my head is killing me. I can't keep my eyes open. this place. Time. Memory. The only thing I remember clearly is Charlotte, my doll. Nobody says we can't. Let's find Charlotte. Let's search the wards on the upper floor. There's a plan on the wall which shows their location. No, no, she's freezing. She's alone. Let's look for her. Mummy took good care of Charlotte. She tucked her in, hugged her, gave her cuddles and kisses. She was very affectionate and loving. Nothing bad happened to Charlotte, and that surprised me. I didn't understand. At first, I was quite scared. I was afraid that she wanted to hurt me. I lived in constant fear that Mom would abandon her. Because I didn't deserve to live. I didn't deserve to be loved. It's cold and it's dark. Look, she's cold. She'll get ill. We can take care of her. Nobody can stop us. Charlotte is a good girl. Those lamps could make the room warmer, but Charlotte's not happy. She doesn't feel well. Charlotte is cold. Let's take her somewhere warm. I saw a wheelchair on the ground floor. It's comfortable there, and we can put Charlotte somewhere warm. Sure, it's warm in the sun, but it gets cold in the evening, and that's not good for Charlotte. He'll get angry. I know he'll get angry. He'll get angry. I know he'll get angry. Thank you. Charlotte will be comfy here. But it's cold. No, it's cold. Don't shiver, Charlotte. The cold will go away. It'll go away. We must find some warm lights. Let's go to the surgical ward. The cold has gone away now. You see? The light. The warmth. We can do it. The cold will go away. It has to. Now we can enter the ward where everything started. It all began in the observation ward on the ground floor. blinding, merciless light. I was 16 years old, and I was afraid. Always afraid. A fear that wore me down. I needed help, but I couldn't speak. I was terrified of everything, even thinking. They said they were taking me to a place where the fear would go away, where I would get better. I stopped living in there. They dragged me away and stripped off all my clothes, everything. I tried to explain what was going on in my head. They tied me to the bed for days. I was alone with my nightmares. It wasn't fear anymore. It was madness. And when you're mad, you cease to exist. She was my only hope in this hell. I was descending down, down among the damned. But that woman and her smile kept me alive. The door is locked from the outside. Here, the doors can only be locked and unlocked from the outside. You can't get out of here. Only the dead can leave this place. He left, panted, and slobbered all over me. It hurt me when he touched me. I thought I'd suddenly split open with a loud crack, and I would be shattered into pieces. I felt fragile, sick, dirty, degraded. All I could do was clutch Charlotte tightly while he... Rene obeyed. He was the master in the realm of light. I was being consumed by the evil act I had committed. I threw up and could feel hell getting closer and closer. Those tests the doctors did to me. They said there was something growing inside, and they wanted to drag it out of me.
Thank you.
She stayed with Renee during those terrible medical examinations, and that gave her the strength to survive. They went to the gynecology ward on the upper floor. August 21st, 1938. Confidential. Dear A, I know what you think about these things, so I'm referring a patient to you, Renee T. This wretched girl got out of control and caused trouble in the grounds. She's almost 3 months pregnant. The nurses should be more alert. I'm examining the girl on the 28th. I'll handle things very carefully, don't worry. We don't want to make matters worse.
Then
they said that Renee was crazy and that the illness was all in her head.
Careful, little girl, careful.
I was scared, and I didn't talk to anyone about the illness. Only her. Not even the other doctor.
He never touched Renee. He just wrote things down. You can tell me everything. Don't be afraid, he said. Everything's going to be fine. Do you want to know what I am writing? I note down what I observe in you, everything I see.
He didn't hate Renee. He tried to help her, but he rarely examined her in those small surgeries.
June 1935. After much theorizing and practice in clinics for the privileged, the moment for action has finally arrived. Volterra is the right place. It's an avant-garde hospital, the perfect place for a doctor who really wants to make a difference. November 20th. Crossing the threshold of the asylum was similar to entering another dimension. A world of smells, noises, and images which it is almost impossible to imagine, describe, or explain. August 1936. The situation is similar to that in many other institutions. The department is overcrowded. Hundreds of patients are supervised by a handful of nurses who are forced to tie the more distressed ones to their beds or to radiators. They do 24-hour shifts. It's impossible to work like this. We doctors rarely see the female patients, and it's the nurses who tell us what's happening to the women.
The doctor who wrote things down was in Surgery C.
March 12th, 1938.
Renee T., 16 years old. Menstruation at age 12. Housewife. father unknown, mother a seamstress.
Admitted an observation yesterday morning from Pontedera, accompanied by a police officer authorized by the examining magistrate of the Court of Pisa, to be admitted for a psychiatric evaluation, which I have carried out. Medical certificate. Mental illness preceded by warning signs. Has suffered from depression for a year, believing she had tuberculosis. Food deprivation.
We can't read this document. It is forbidden. We mustn't. If they find out, there will be trouble.
We have to look for Amara. We must hurry. We have to follow the memories and make sure they don't fade. She is frightened, hears noises and ghosts, presents serious signs of anxiety psychosis, suffers from hallucinations. She is anxious, confused, her expression is distressed, a questioning look as if terrified, disoriented. She feels confused, hears voices shouting in her head, she doesn't understand things properly. She has been feeling unwell for 2 or 3 months. When questioned, she replies, "My mother wants to hurt me. I am always scared of her. She chases me."
"Why are you here?"
"I argued with my mother and was so upset that I felt like my head was spinning. There was a woman there who wanted to force me into a life of prostitution. They wanted to condemn me to be burned at the stake. Children whispered, called my name." March 16th. She couldn't sleep last night. They wanted to condemn her to be burned at the stake. April 4th. Transferred to the calm ward, still under my supervision.
"Yes, that's true. The ward where Amara was. Yes, the stake. The children wanted to burn Renee. She had to pay for what she'd done, like witches at the stake."
So many things frightened me. The system that I lived in was built on fear and light. There was no mercy or understanding in the town of light. April 21st. She's more awake this morning and is responding to questions, complains of headaches. She became agitated when she found out her mother was there. She says that one day, many years earlier, she was with a friend of hers and met a man who made her get into a car and took her for a ride. He made her smoke cigarettes and drink liquor, and the man showed her certain things. He tried to hurt her and made her go crazy. She says he promised to marry her and made her swear to keep what had happened a secret. These facts were essentially confirmed by her mother. After that, she became arrogant, impatient, and hostile towards her family, especially her mother. She started taking off her clothes in public. Her moods would swing from laughter to tears. She rants. She pleasures herself.
"I can't remember these things, only the guilt, the stake. I know I deserve to pay for that guilt. I knew it even then."
"Amara, she was good. Let's look for her. What else can we do?"
the grounds at the back of the hospital, and then down to the kitchens. This is the road we used to take. If it weren't for her, in the grounds on that bench in spring, so many days. It was an escape, watching nature around us as she talked and smiled. And then there were the kitchens. Sometimes we stole food and ran back to the bench to eat it in secret, and we laughed. She did things to me. Sometimes she touched me. In the shower, I felt her body against mine for the first time. It was a shiver that warmed my soul. Eyes closed, the light slipped away. She wasn't in the system. He wouldn't let her in. That's it. She must be the key to my memories, to the reasons why. Nature helped me to forget, to escape from the system. scent of spring. The land of light was far away, and we spent the days chatting on the stone benches.